If you care about your thyroid health and you eat millet, or if you eat gluten-free foods and don't check the ingredients, you need to watch this video. Hi, I'm Dr. Chris Masterjohn of chrismasterjohnphd.com. You're watching Chris Masterjohn Lite, where the name of the game is details, schmeetails. Just tell me what works. And today we are going to be talking about why you should moderate your millet. Now, millet is a grain, and it's generally been a staple of the poor rural populations of the Sudan, India, Pakistan, and Africa. In these places in modern society, quite often millet is consumed at very large amounts in the rural villages and in smaller amounts in the more densely populated towns. Now, we first started looking into the goitrogenic effect of millet, which means the ability of millet to hurt the thyroid gland and cause a disorder that not only makes you feel really bad and decreases your cognitive function and your energy and makes your hair fall out and all of this stuff, but also it's so bad that the thyroid gland struggles to try to produce enough thyroid hormone, and in doing so, it enlarges. And if it's bad, it can get to the point where the enlargement is actually visible in the neck. Now, in the 1980s, we started investigating the effect of millet because the prevalence of goiter was really, really high in the rural villages of Sudan. And in 1981, investigators tried to understand why. So one thing that was clear was iodine intake was pretty low across the board. But that wasn't all of it. So in the towns, there was a much lower prevalence of goiter and there was a much lower intake of millet. Almost everything about the diet was the same, except that there was more wheat and sorghum consumed and less millet. The association with millet was so striking that where millet was consumed as one-third of the calories, goiter in school children was about 10% for boys and 13% for girls. But when millet increased from one-third of the calories to two-thirds of the calories, in boys, the prevalence of goiter jumped from 10% to 35%, and in girls, it jumped from 13% to 55%. In one of the villages, the intake of millet reached 73% of calories. In that village, 46% of the boys and 75% of the girls had goiter. The association with millet was so striking that investigators started studying millet. What does it do to animals? What are the interactions with other nutrients? Does it matter how the millet is processed? And a couple things became clear from those experiments. First of all, the goitrogens, the compounds that have a negative impact on the thyroid gland, were present in multiple parts of the millet. They were present in the bran, which is removed during hulling and refining, and they were present in the endosperm, which is the starchy part that you eat even if you refine the grain. So refining the grain isn't going to do anything. Then they tested, what is the effect of iodine? Adding iodine to the rats in the animal experiments didn't do anything to protect against the millet. Then they asked, what is the effect of cooking? The effect of cooking was to make it worse. Then they asked, what is the effect of traditional processing? In the Sudan, where goiter prevalence was really, really high, they dehulled the millet, then they soaked it for 2 to 5 days in water, which allowed it to ferment. The soaking water was so likely to burn your skin that they wouldn't let their children near it, and they discarded it. So investigators took millet, subjected it to traditional processing, and it made it far more goitrogenic. Across the board, there was nothing that was ever found to reduce the goitrogenicity of millet, except a process called semi-wet milling. Now, I don't think any of us are going to have a semi-wet milling process in our homes. That would probably be the only way to deal with this. But even still, what they showed was that if you use this process to keep the moisture a certain percentage when you milled it that was just right, and then you milled it, and then you fed it as a raw flour to the animals, it wouldn't be goitrogenic. But we know that the starchy part has the goitrogens, and we know that they're activated multiple fold by cooking. So all told, the evidence shows that there is not anything that you can do to avoid the goitrogenic effect of millet except to eat less millet. Now, I think the real problem is when people don't realize that they're eating all this millet. So the perfect example of that is going to be people who are eating gluten-free breads. Let's Google gluten-free bread. As we go through the Google results, we have some ads. And if we go to the top result, it's Udi's gluten-free. Breads, rolls, and buns. The first product that comes up is this millet chia bread. Now, the ingredients are water. That's not going to hurt you. Tapioca starch. Like we talked about in one of the previous videos, tapioca starch, which comes from cassava, increases your need for iodine. That's not a problem because you can just eat an iodine-rich diet and it's not going to be a big deal. But if you're not paying attention to that and you're eating an iodine-poor diet and you have tapioca starch that's increasing your need for iodine and you're adding millet, then that's going to be a big problem. So you see millet seed is the second ingredient. If you are eating gluten-free breads and you're not conscious about this, you could very easily wind up in the position where you're eating a lot of millet. So I really, really think that the best thing to do with millet is to not eat a lot of millet. I think if millet's 5 or 10% of your diet, it's probably fine. Millet is 0% of my diet, but certainly don't allow it to become 20 or 30% of your diet. All right, I hope you found this useful. Signing off, this is Chris Masterjohn of chrismasterjohnphd.com. You've been watching Chris Masterjohn Lite, and I will see you in the next video.